Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch, and I'm here with Jade Abbott and Bonaventure Dossou from the Masakhane Initiative. Today, we're getting enthusiastic about natural language processing research in African languages for Africans by Africans. Hello, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us, Gretchen. Hi.
Hi, thank you for having us.
Thank you both for coming. And so I know that Masakhane is a big group of people, so you are two parts of it, but there are other people who are also involved. But let's start with sort of backing up a step and talking about how you both got interested in language in the first place. Jade, do you want to start?
Of course. So I got interested in language kind of from a very young age when originate from South Africa, which has a very traumatic past with a lot of division. And one of the things that when I was growing up, I noticed that I was never taught to speak African languages, despite the fact I was living in South Africa. And when I did try learn the languages, I ended up with a lot of anxiety in trying to get through this. And so being in computer science, I turned to technology as a means to do this. And the reason that it mattered to me so much was, and I don't want to be the cheesy person to quote Nelson Mandela, but I'm going to do it. He says, when you speak to someone in a language they understand, it goes to their head. If you speak to them in their own language, it goes to their heart. And this, I fundamentally believe on the importance of communication. Mm-hmm. And so for me, it was a matter of like bridging like a not only just a communication divide, but also like a cultural divide and kind of bringing people together. So this is why I cared a lot about language. And it was from that point of view, that feeling that we're all the kind of Masakhane initiative sort of was envisioned from my side. So this is, you know, we started getting into it from a technological perspective, being like, how can we use technology to kind of support either translation of these languages or using them in a technological space? And we realized that there was just nothing, no research, nothing was available. And so, yeah, that's sort of what spawned off Masakhane.
Cool. And Bona, how did you start getting involved with this?
So I grew up in Benin, a country where French is spoken. And also, like Jade, I did not get much exposed to my native language, which is Fon and also Gung, simply because in Benin, everything is done in French. And also at school, I mean, you were like forced to speak French. Otherwise, if you were caught speaking the language, I mean, the native language and everything, you could have been punished or expelled from the school, either temporarily or either definitively. So I always had passion for language, but not my native language. I had passion for English because I wanted to become a computer scientist. I wanted to travel abroad, do great things and everything. I knew that English would be definitely important for me. And as a matter of fact, I was very, very big fan of Michael Jackson. So I used to buy his CDs. I used to go on the internet, Google the lyrics and look at the sounds, trying to understand every meaning of the lyrics because I believed that understanding the song could help me to dance better somehow. So yeah, that's how I got interested in language. But only recently, when I traveled abroad in Russia, I had a lot of communication problem issues, mainly with my mom, who cannot really speak well French. And yeah, that's basically from where the whole envy and idea of working on African languages started. And like they say, great and beautiful minds always meet together. So finally, we met Masakhane, and yeah, so here we are today.
Yeah, so the Masakhane initiative started in 2019, is that right?
Yes.
And Bona, you got involved in 2020?
Yeah, I remember it was January 2020.
What an interesting time to get involved in something. And so you two are just part of this organization. Do you want to talk a bit more about how, maybe Jay, this is a question for you, people started coming together and forming, you know, groups and collaborations and so on within this project?
Yeah, so how it started is we were sitting, it was my co-author, Laura, who was the person I used to originally write these publications with around African languages. And we were at a conference, the ACL conference.
That's the Association of Computational Linguistics? Not the American one. There are ones in lots of areas.
There are a whole bunch. There isn't one in Africa yet.
Yet. Could change that.
Yes. And we were at publishing at the what they call the widening NLP, so the widening natural language processing workshop. And when we were there, we realized we were one of two groups of African attendees. And wow. One group was from Ethiopia and the other group was us, to the point where the researchers were who cared about low-resource languages were actively seeking us out to be like, oh, great, we have people from our continent of Africa. Yeah, we should meet them. And from chatting to everyone and from our own research, we realized that the problem is so dire. There was so little representation of African languages kind of in language technology that we needed to sort of build a African, pan-African-wide community. And so, thankfully, there's a great initiative called the Deep Learning Indaba. And the goal of the Deep Learning Indaba is to kind of strengthen machine learning in Africa. And they deal with all aspects of machine learning. And what they essentially did is brought together researchers and industry professionals from around the continent and put them through these workshops. And what was great is that, I knew that if I could go present this idea of like, hey, let's build a community of four African languages, let's make these NLP tools, let's work together, and then let's write this huge paper with 50 authors to show people how we're going to change the world. And what was great is that we already had like a big group of people who were involved. So initially we started up already with 50 people from all over the continent who were active in the Slack groups and helping write code. And right now, even since that moment, we've been working virtually. So when the pandemic happened and suddenly everyone was confined, we had little to no change. In fact, it might have been the opposite. I think people had a lot more spare time to work on it.
Because you were already doing things across the entire continent, yeah. And so you were collaborating virtually anyway, so it didn't change that much. And so you were piggybacking on an existing group of people who were interested in technology stuff and saying, hey, maybe you should care about technology and language together.
Yes, pretty much. And there was already a group caring about it, but we said, let's make a focus group. Let's write a paper together. Let's try to solve this representation issue as a group.
And how did you get involved, Bona?
So I remember the story was funny because I was sorry if I can go a little bit back to give more context. So I was working at the company and I built like kind of, let me call it a translation tool that was kind of using, that had the languages of Google Translate, but that was not really using Google Translate. And I did it in Python and I tried to implement the API and everything integrated to the mobile application that I was also building. It was a kind of African social network application. So I integrated I integrated it to the feed. So for instance, if I publish something in English, someone else can see it in Yoruba or whatever. I mean, those languages available on Google Translate. I also integrated it to the chat so that if I write something in French, you decide in which language you wanted to see it. So, So now we run into conflict of, I won't call it conflict of interest, but I built the whole thing like because of my interest in the NLP, which is also dependent of another event that happened to my brother, colleague Chris and I when we were in Russia, but that would be too long to talk about. So, so finally they wanted to take the product and everything, talking about intellectual properties and everything. So I thought, finally I gave up. And then after Chris joined us, Chris is the one who brought that idea of working on African languages. So we started working on Lingala. Thing didn't went quite well because we're trying to let them know how it should be, but they were like, who are you? Who dare you? How can you speak like that? Who do you think you are? Patati patata. And then things went down, broke down. And then finally we left. And then we're actively looking for people working on those ideas, like those African languages. So we left the company like somewhere in November. And then in December, I think it was Chris who found on Twitter exactly Deep Learning in the bar tweet, which was retweeting about AI for development. So they talked about that platform Zindi, and then there was a contest about African languages dataset. And we're like, okay, great, that's a good idea. So then we just jumped in, And we started working on gathering data for phone and everything. And I mean, you know, when you retreat, finally you can reach the source, right? So in one of those retreats, I found the Twitter post of Masakhane, and then I went on the website and I was like, I shared with Chris, I was like, wow, this is great if we can join and everything. So Chris was like, well, let's wait. Maybe there are only professionals there. Let us wait, finish, because we're still undergraduates. So everything we've been doing now, we honestly just planned it like for now. I mean, to start now or to start after we graduate from the master. But I was like, okay, I don't care. So most of the time it's like that. Chris is much, a little bit pessimist. And I'm just like, okay, I just do it. Like if the worst that can happen is it doesn't work, but then at least I have tried. So I just went to the website and filled. There was a form to fill out an email address. So I sent both of our CVs and everything. And yeah, we just got accepted. And then we just got in. And that's how it started.
And for context, Gretchen, Bona comes as a duo. It's usually Bona and Chris. When I met them together.
it's technical limitations that prevent us from interviewing all three of you. There's a really interesting presentation if people want to see some of the faces of more of the group of Masakhane. The video presentation that you did a few months ago, which we can link to, that has, you know, snippets from about what 10 or so people and different parts of the project that they're involved with.
Yeah, it was a very fun talk. So we took full advantage of the digital format and edited and put a whole bunch of people and made things move around.
it's such a good talk because, you know, a lot of conference talks are sort of like, okay, here's one person and there's like a kind of bad quality video over some slides. And yours is actually like a multimedia thing and there's music and there's sort of little animations of the people moving in and out. I think it's just a really beautiful video, especially considering that it was originally a conference talk, which are often pretty boring.
Yeah, that was actually all edited by Chris. I think the amount of energy that went into editing that, putting it together and coordinating so many people.
Oh, yeah. And all the talks fit together really well. And of course, none of you would have been in the same location at all.
Mm. Yeah. If we'd done this conference talk, we would not have all been there, right? Just simply due to visa issues or costs. Like, we could never have done this if it weren't digital.
Yeah, you're not going to fly like a dozen people to a conference to give a single talk where each of them talks for 5 minutes or something like that.
I mean, we would do that. We just probably... We probably wouldn't get everyone in.
Just be a lot of logistical issues preventing
you. Yeah, so many. Yeah. I mean, yeah, the logistical issues that face Africans kind of outweigh the logistical issues from many parts of the world. So, for instance, actually, majority of Africa struggles to get into the US. They've had multiple instances of conference goers. People who are running and organizing a conference cannot get a visa for Canada where the conference is being held. So it's actually really interesting to see how, you know, a lot of people, this conference has changed to being something really dull and boring, but it actually enabled so many more people from around the world, especially from Africa, to actually attend and participate.
And so there's some benefits to the digital conferences because you don't need a visa. And
no.
And this maybe gets us into talking about how you've also sort of creatively subverted the traditional sort of authorship models when it comes to writing papers as a collective for Masakhane.
Yeah, it was really interesting because we have this idea, and it's particularly rare in the technology sphere, where typically you have the researchers and then you've got everyone else in the world. So everyone else's things being studied, data being collected, participants, they're not actually part of the research process. So we said, no, everyone who contributed, no matter how big or small, so was it an edit you did? Was it a model you contributed? Was it a small evaluation you did? You were, you know, added as an author. And we were sitting discussing, and we had 50 authors on this paper. And I was like, we're trying to figure out what order they should be in. So we like randomized it. We said it from, you know, from reverse alphabetical, because that seemed fine. And then someone was like, hey, why don't we just put a symbol as to represent the community? Because that's actually what we want the first author to be.
And especially with a paper with 50 authors, it often gets cited as like so-and-so et al.
Et al, exactly.
And yet, if that turns into like Abbott et al, that looks like it's your project, which it's not. You're trying to decentralize that.
Yeah, so we added in the for all symbol as our first author.
And that's this upside down capital A.
The mathematical symbol. Yes, yeah. Which is referenced the whole set, right? And it's actually encapsulated in our logo. So if you look at the Masakhane logo, there's actually sort of a for all symbol hidden in there amongst it. So yeah, we did that. The conferences weren't happy. They kept trying to ignore the symbol. We kept trying to argue otherwise. Turns out they don't represent the character sets on the proceedings websites. And that's a bit strange to me.
Well, especially for something that's a computational linguistics conference, you would think that they would have, you know, Unicode support and the ability to support special characters and things, because lots of people actually have those in their names as well.
Yes. So by the end of it, I was like, I wasn't sure if it was like a technical incapability or if they just didn't want to set a precedent that you could just do this, but I can't see why you shouldn't be able to just do this. This seems fine, right? We should be able to have symbols as fifth authors. If we can have cats as 10th authors and dogs as fifth authors, then why can't we have a symbol?
There are indeed famously papers that have cats yes. sometimes as a co-author.
Yes.
And so do you want to talk about some of the specific projects that people have been working on under the whole Masakhane umbrella? Bona, I know you've been making a translator for a phone.
Yeah, so that's Masakhane is a huge family. Of course, the focus is in NLP. We first started as machine translation community, then we moved broader to more topics of NLP, like speech and everything. So yeah, started with a translation engine for phone, which is my native language, widely spoken in Benin. The most spoken language, if we discard the colonial language and administrative language, which is French. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we basically started by phone. Thankfully, we managed, and the platform is actually already online, useful, and we got thousands already of translation suggestions, feedbacks, and everything. I mean, we've been working on many things. But the other second major thing is a speech recognition stuff model, I would say, for phone and for Igbo. And for phone is actually, it's already working. We have both models working, even though for phone was much more better. So for phone, we're mainly public and is also hosted on the website of Hugging Face. So people can actually just go there. Register the voices and then have the transcription of it. So yeah, that's basically what I'm working on. But there are other people like who have focused on same thing like NMT, like machine translation, but for other languages like Yoruba and everything, speech recognition as well, or name entity recognition or part of speech, POS tagging and everything. So subjects are broad actually, and somehow we managed to get at least a bit of each of the members. And I think that's how the strife is built.
Yeah, it was neat. I was going on your website earlier last week and clicking around and saying, okay, I can try to use this phone translator and I can type something in French because, you know, I speak French. And then it presents me with this result. And I have obviously no way of telling whether it's a good phone translation or not because I don't speak it. But it looked like it was doing something, which is all that I can evaluate. And that's the whole problem because not everyone, you know, necessarily speaks every language involved there. But the thing that I did notice was that it had an option for, is this translation incorrect? You know, do you want to change something? And presumably you're using that to help improve the translator.
Yes. So you're definitely right. And we included that to have much more translation to include more people because like I work on the project with Chris and with two other people who are not computer scientists. Who are not in the field of data science and NLP, they are just like linguistics person, people like journalists, media communicators and everything. So they actually know anything about those tools, but they help us with checking the qualities of the translation and everything. And on our side, we wanted to have more data, more translations to improve the service. So, but we knew we could not do it alone. We knew that it will make a huge difference involving people that speak the language. And yeah, this is what made us put that form so that people could suggest translations and score the translation. The score, mm-hmm. the translation score would help us to filter, because if someone is giving a translation with the confidence score of 1/5, we are actually not really sure that we'll go for it. Maybe we select it, but then like we won't put give it much more attention than someone who is sure like who has given 3.2.5 or 4 over 5 to the translation he suggested.
Because, if you know, if you have, like, some users could be trolls or something and not giving very good results, and then you want to be able to sort of filter for which of those translations are good. And so, you know, one of the things with machine translation and with natural language processing and stuff in general is it generally needs a whole lot of data, right, to do it. And especially for translation, you need translation pairs where you have something that's, here's a bit in one language, here's a bit in another language that corresponds to it. And then eventually, if you have enough of these, you can try to teach the computer to produce other translations. What are the challenges with getting some of this data in the first place and, you know, keeping on doing things with it afterwards?
I mean, what's fun about, you know, majority of the languages we see that translation systems exist for is you can just go on the internet and kind of scrape these kind of parallel corpuses and do something they call alignment, which tries to say, okay, these are the sentences that are parallel. And typically people will use Wikipedia as a good example to try source these parallel pairs. They'll use news websites where they've got translations for them. And that's all good and well for languages which are well represented on the internet. Mm-hmm. But for many of the African languages, that is simply not the case. In fact, sometimes even the keyboards in order to type in that language don't even exist. Bona actually worked on one for fun so that people could
download it. So it does now, but it didn't. Yeah.
Yes, and it didn't. Or spell checkers don't exist in those languages. So there's also been a recent project by one of our collaborators, Sabello Slabi, who's also put together a number of spell checkers for Southern African languages. So it doesn't exist. And I think what's really interesting when you speak to Western or people who are not used to working in these low-resource languages, they contact us and they want to find out what websites can we scrape. And we have to come back and say, no, you have to hire people to translate. Or you need to go back into archives and look up stuff.
You need to take 3 steps back and actually start at this earlier thing. Yeah.
So we've had like really fun stories of, for instance, the South African Parliament got a great law that mm-hmm. says we have to translate all of our parliamentary proceedings into as many all of our 11 official languages, which apparently does happen, but doesn't get published. And the only way we got hold of that data was one of the translators for Parliament happens to be on our project. And she was like, I can get the data. I can even get permission. You just have to help me with this really annoying tool and that I can't figure out to get it out of there.
Because they're all in PDFs or something annoying.
They're in PDFs. Sometimes they're in docx's. You have to download them from some weird FTP. You can only do it in tiny batches because otherwise the system falls over. It's just like trying to get it. And they're like, you can have it. It's like, but how? How do we get to it? And then we've had a couple of participants get really involved in saying, you know, they want to really dictate, you know, what gets translated. So not just what's mm-hmm. already been translated. They want to translate or use translations. It doesn't even have to be translated. They want to capture any data about this, their language in question. And they want to decide what goes in. They don't want it to be what is typically available, which is religious texts is very widely translated. That's majority of what we have. Yep. They go into, you know, their communities, they sit with their grandmother and, you know, on a Sunday drink coffee and, you know, work together. She'll translate from English into her language and write it up. And then we'd collect those pieces of paper. Someone would scan them in. Someone would then type it up using the right keyboard if they can get hold of it. So there's like quite a lengthy process,
right,
which is part preservation and part hopefully can be used to, you know, build tools that can facilitate learning these languages. And yeah, if we don't do that, then the models do very strange things. So,
well, I imagine, you know, religious text, like most people don't talk like a religious text in their ordinary life.
No, they don't.
And the language model only understands what it's already seen.
Yep.
And so you could try to say something pretty normal and it would make it sound like a weird prophecy or something.
Yeah, so we do that. I remember, so we did in one of our first papers, we did an analysis. So someone said, oh, we need to translate COVID-19 surveys. You should use machine translation. And we said, that's going to be a fun evaluation exercise. There's no way you can use anything that comes out of it. But it was a great demonstration to show kind of the failures of this process.
Because all of this medical vocabulary is not going to be in your religious text that you're using.
Yeah. So for instance, Canada got translated into Canaan, you know, like things became biblified.
Oh, like Canaan. Oh no.
Canaan. And that would keep happening. So we got a lot of that. But we use that as an evaluation exercise. So we'd have a native speaker come and correct whatever the machine did. It was quite a laugh for us, but also a little bit horrifying if you're thinking that people are actually training these models without knowing how good or bad they are, because they don't have a team who understands it.
Yeah, imagine giving someone this advice, you know, save yourself from the plague of locusts or something by going to Canaan, and you're like, wait, no, there's got to be something going on here and I don't know what it is.
What are you trying to tell me, computer? Why are you telling me this?
But now you must have a bunch of translated data from like COVID announcements and the pandemic and things like that, because a lot of those did get produced in lots of languages.
Yeah, so I think some of them we do have. I don't know. I don't think we've done like a recent gathering of them. We probably should, and just kind of bolster our training sets. I think we're still overwhelmingly dominated by religious text. But we're sorting that out. So there's a number of funds that have come through. And so they want to. So, for example, Bona was talking earlier about this Zindi competition. Zindi is a data science platform where someone will release a data set or a challenge, and programmers will go on, or data scientists will go on and participate in this competition. And Zindi is an African data science platform. And one of our close collaborators was running a competition that was, I think, funded by UNESCO. And the goal there was to fund creation of data sets, which was really helpful. So now we have data sets that are being created, which means people go get things annotated. They work with journalists to get things written. We knew people who were working on annotating and translating, you know, their master's theses or a collection of poems they'd written to do this. And there are some funds that are available to do so. So instead of scraping, we go and create more content and try to spur that into the world so that we have more.
Yeah, that's really neat. And of course, as Bona was just saying, once you can put some sort of machine translation or something up, then you can also get people to contribute directly to rating it and adding new things.
Exactly, which is what we've done. We actually recently deployed translate.masakhane.io, where we have a number of English to about 6 or 7 African languages. We actually have 38 models that currently exists. We just haven't deployed them all. And yeah, right now it only goes English into the African languages, but we're going to swap that around. So it does from African language to English too, and then also from African language to African language. And yeah, it's also this idea of extending participation from just the Masakhane group, which is quite large, but extending that to as many people across the continent who'd like to participate and add translations.
That's great. So I guess there's sort of at the individual levels, a bunch of people are still going to keep making projects underneath that. You know, Bona, do you want to talk about where you see things going? What's next for you and what else you're working on?
Okay, so what's next? I think it depends. I think already the bigger and the main goal of the family or the community is already, I mean, been step by step, slowly but steadily achieved. Like, people know more now about African languages. People are more conscious about it, about the challenges and everything. More content are created. African languages have much more visibility now. I think, like, it was hard to even find a paper that was talking about fun because it simply did not. But actually, thanks to the Masakhane community, Chris and I and everything, they are not a lot, but at least, like, already more than 2, 3 and everything. So on the personal side, Jade mentioned African to African, which is good to me and also to Chris. So we started with NMT, with machine translation. Now we've done and we're still working on speech. And that's basically like NMT, speech, and maybe we'll do that cycle. And after maybe move to something else, we also talk about tokenization to improve the translation quality. So me, I'm very interested in a future where, for example, we could have assistants with which we could just talk in phone instead of having Siri or Alexa to which we are speaking French or English. We could have those assistants to which we are speaking our languages. That would be fun. That would actually give a whole more of sense to everything we are working on, having those languages models that we are training integrated to mobile phones, the keyboard that we are building, or the spell checkers that Jade mentions, those things integrated to every daily technology, phones, laptops, and everything. I think that would be a milestone I don't know what would come after that, but I think that would be already a very great step.
By the time you get there, you could notice other things that you'd want as well.
Yes, definitely. So like one step at a time, like they used to say.
Yeah, absolutely. And Masakhane won an award from Wikimedia for a lot of this work in this area.
Yes, Masakhane did. We all did.
It was really cool because Bonner and Chris accepted the award directly from Jimmy Wales himself and gave beautiful acceptance speeches. I think that was somewhere on the internet if anyone wants to go listen.
Oh, we can find the links to those.
Yeah, they're lovely.
So if somebody says, wow, this is really cool, I hadn't thought about this before, I want to learn more about this project or I want to get more involved with this project, what would you suggest they go to?
First of all, I think, of course, I would invite them to come to the community first. And I think people will benefit a lot from it because we have like weekly mentoring sessions, study NLPs, weekly meetings, people are working on very cool and interesting project. Like, it doesn't matter if they are beginners, if they are computer scientists or whatever. Like, everybody is taken like a baby and then like we grow step by step together. Yeah, and then already when they join, they can now have their own interest. And then depending on the interest they have, they now can move to anything they want. Like, they can check the papers written by Jade and Laura, or maybe the paper I wrote with Chris, the papers the community read, like the paper for which we got the Wikimedia Award, Research Paper of the Year Award. I mean, there are a lot of things they actually can do. Thankfully, with our work, not to be too much showing off with our work, there are actually much more really content, much more publication, much more resources that can be found online for anybody that wants to start working on African low resource languages.
Yeah, awesome. And we'll link to some of those in the show notes so people want to follow links to the Masakhane website or to other places. Jade, any resource that you'd lead people with?
Yeah, so I would recommend anyone who's interested to get hold of a book by Kenyan author Ngugi wa Thiong'o called Decolonizing the Mind, The Politics of Language in African Literature. This book is probably one of the most impactful books for African language, even though he wasn't a linguist. He was just an author. He was an author who, after writing this, chose to only write in his native language of Kikuyu. And it kind of situates one of the big Masakhane beliefs, which is, if I may read a quote.
Sure.
Where he says, language carries culture, and culture carries, particularly through orator and literature, the entire body of values by which we come to perceive ourselves and our place in the world. How people perceive themselves affects how they look at their culture, at their politics, and at their social production of wealth, at their entire relationship to nature and to other beings. Language is thus inseparable from ourselves as a community of human beings with a specific form and character, a specific history, a specific relationship to the world. And this is sort of what Masakhane calls for, is this idea of, I think what happens a lot in language technology spheres is language is seen as data, and data is just seen as something you put in and out of a machine. Whereas, you know, only if we start acknowledging language for what it is, a representation of human beings and human culture, then we can actually start, you know, building tools that actually aid humanity rather than just exploit. And it's also how we propose solving this kind of low-resourced issue that's facing African languages. So yeah, I would recommend this book to anyone. It's basically a series of essays around his thoughts around African literature and playwrights and stories.
This sounds great. I'm going to have to check it out.
It's great.
That almost brings us to a close, but we always like to give our guests one more chance to say, if you could leave people knowing one thing about language or about the problems that you work on, what would that be?
I will just say that I forgot the name of the author. Like, it's a lady who said that, I don't really remember word for word, but what she was saying was basically that working on language is much more complicated than any other problem that we could imagine. And like Jane was saying, from Wa Thiong'o, language carries a lot of things with itself. Like, carries principles, carries values, it carries culture, it carries heritage, carries a lot of things that altogether gives an identity to a human being, a group of human beings. So I would say language is very important, language matters. And if our bigger vision of putting Africa on the NLP map, but more generally putting, let me say, AI in the heart of Africa's development, then it necessarily compulsory starts by giving value to our languages, by promoting our cultures and everything, because if we don't do, nobody else will do it for us. And I think we've been waiting already for too long, so it's time for us to get things done by ourselves.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, not judging your grammar, just analyzing it, t-shirts, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com. My book about internet language is called Because Internet. Lauren tweets and blogs as Superlingo, and the Masakhane Initiative can be found at masakhane.io. That's masakhane.io. And as at MasakhaneNLP on Twitter. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to over 50 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include talking to babies, Pokemon names, and our live show episode on backchanneling. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay, too. We also really appreciate it if you recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life. Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gaughan. Our senior producer is Claire Gaughan, our editorial producer is Sarah Dobbirala, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay enthusiastic.
Stay enthusiastic.